they are related to biology. Most of them, they represent cells. So indeed, quantitative phase microscopies, there are mostly tools for biologists. And the main message of my presentation is that you can do a lot of things also for nanophotonics. As soon as you image a phase of light, this can be interesting for biology, but also for photonics. So what does quantitative phase microscopy measures? What does it mean measuring the phase of light? So if you consider you have a microscope, and in the focal plane of the microscope, you have an object, which is characterized by a refractive index n. You send some light on top of it, and when the light beam will cross the sample, it will get distorted because of this refractive index difference from the environment. So a quantitative phase microscopy technique measures this wavefront distortion, this profile delta you see here. So delta is not D, okay? D is a geometrical profile of the object, which can be measured, for instance, by an AFM. Delta, it's not D, it's related to the by this expression here. So delta is called the optical thickness. It's D times the difference of the refractive index n minus n1. So delta is what is measured, the optical thickness, this is what is measured by a quantitative phase microscopy technique. So why do we talk about phase imaging then? Well, that's because the phase is proportional to the optical thickness of the object, using this relation here. And this is, as an example, some images you can acquire when you look at living cells using a quantitative phase microscopy technique. So I think you can guess what the interest is of looking at phase instead of intensity. If you image a living cell using an intensity camera, you don't see much because living cells, they are mostly transparent. You do have some refraction that creates some signal within cells, but not that much. However, if you look at phase, the contrast is huge. The contrast is much better. You can see details within cells. So this is why quantitative phase microscopy techniques are widely used in biology. So now let's see what is the technique, the microscopy technique we have been using so far at the Fresnel Institute. So this technique is called quadrivalve lateral shearing interferometry. The name is complicated, but the technique is very simple. So don't be afraid by the name of the technique. And I would even say this is one of the simplest technique, phase microscopy technique you can think of, but at the same time, also one of the most powerful microscopy technique, phase microscopy technique you can have. So how is it working? You just have, when I say it's very simple, it is to plug this camera on your microscope and you get these images. I'm not kidding, this is as simple as this. This camera is not magic, there is some physics behind. And what you cannot see with this camera here is that in front of the sensor, you have a diffraction grating, a two-dimensional diffraction grating with horizontal lines and vertical lines. And because of this diffraction grating in front of the camera measures what is called an interferogram. It is the image, but on top of the image, you have a grid. So I'm not sure you can see the grid here, but if you zoom in, you see it, all these dots. These dots correspond to horizontal lines and vertical lines. And so when the optical plane, optical wavefront is uniform, you have parallel lines, and when it is distorted, you have a distortion of the fringes. And then using a Fourier transform algorithm, you can retrieve the phase from the interferogram, looking at this displacement, this distortion of the fringes. So this is how quadrivalve lateral shearing interferometry is working. So the benefit is that it's very simple. You plug a camera, it's working, but also the strong benefit for nanophotonics is that it's high resolution. You have many pixels per unit area compared to other existing phase microscopy techniques. And then you have a very good sensitivity. It can map, it can be sensitive to wavefront distortion, to optical thicknesses of less than a nanometer. And this is a requirement where you are looking at nanoparticles. So what can you do by using QLSI, quadrivalve lateral shearing interferometry for nanophotonics? So far at the Fresnel Institute, we have developed four different applications. So first, imaging living cells. This is what I presented already, but this is not related to nanophotonics. Nanophotonics concern three developments. So the first one is imaging a temperature gradient generating by heating of gold nanoparticles on the microscale. The second application is characterizing 2D materials. And the third application is imaging nanoparticles. So this is the outline of my talk, but I will do it in reverse order. I will start with nanoparticles, then 2D materials, and then temperature microscopy. So first, I will start with nanoparticle imaging. You have seen what kind of image you have when you image living cells. What about nanoparticles? What do you get and what can you do with images? So this is a very recent work from March of this year. So when you image a nanoparticle, you expect a wavefront distortion that is not really an optical thickness, as I said. It will rather look like an airy pattern, like this. So these are images of a particle acquired by QLSI, intensity and phase. So just to make clear what I mean with intensity and phase, in front of the camera, you have an incoming electric field, which is characterized by a modulus and a phase. The intensity is the square of the modulus, and this is what is usually measured by any camera. What can a QLSI camera do is to image also phi, which is a phase, or also delta, which is the optical thickness of the sample. So this is what the camera is measuring when you are looking at nanoparticles. And again, so you have...
Sorry. There is a question from the chat by Dr. Ivan Sinyov. He's asking, does this technique require spatial and temporal coherence of the illumination?
This is a good point. Actually, not really. You don't need a laser. This is one of the benefits of the technique. To acquire such images, you don't need a laser. Although it is an interferometric technique, you don't need a laser. And I would even say it's worse if you use a laser. I'm not advising you to use a laser with this technique because you have some speckle and fringes on the images. What you need is some spatial coherence, that is true, but you can get it, you can achieve spatial coherence using color illumination. You have a point source and you do your best to have a plane wave from point source. And this is enough and sufficient to have these nice images I am showing here.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much.
So here an example of intensity and phase images of a single gold nanoparticle 100 nanometer peak. So I can guess what you think. These images are very beautiful, very nice, amazing, but okay, it's beautiful, but is it useful? Okay, you can have images, but what can you do with it? Can you make science advance with these images? So the answer is yes. What we have shown in this very recent paper we have published is that once you have intensity and phase, you have everything on the system, all the information you need on the particle. And our intuition was that from this, we could get all the optical properties of the particle. So this was true. And actually we have shown that you can retrieve what is called by mixing these two images, intensity and phase, we can retrieve what is called the complex polarizability of the particle. So basically by multiplying the square root of one image by the exponential of the other, and by summing all the pixels, you get a number, a complex number, that is the complex optical polarizability. So this is very interesting because most of the time, people, techniques do not measure polarizability. This is quite hard to achieve. Most of the time, people measure absorption cross-section, scattering cross-section, extinction, but not really directly the polarizability, which is a shame because a shame, because once you have the polarizability, you have everything you need regarding the optical properties of the particle. In particular, all the cross sections, extensions, scattering, and absorption from the polarizability. So the main conclusion of this approach we had is that with only with a single image, this interferogram, you have all the optical properties you may think of the nanoparticle. So this is a figure taken from the paper. So there are much information, but I will detail them one by one. So first, image A. So we mixed gold nanoparticles with polystyrene nanoparticles. So in orange, you have the gold particles, and in blue are the polystyrene particles. And we applied this expression here, this calculation, for all the spots we have imaged. And we plotted the real and imaginary parts, the complex plane of all the dots. And as expected, we found two clouds of points, one related to gold particles and the other one to polystyrene. And we could quantitatively measure the complex polarizability of the particles. And from these polarizabilities, we could compute as well the optical, the cross-sections, all the cross-sections in image C for gold and polystyrene. We could also vary the wavelengths on the microscope we have to compute the real part and the imaginary part of the polarizability with a very good match with theory. And finally, these are all the cross-section spectrum, extension, scattering, absorption of gold particles. And again, we have a very good match with the theory without any free parameter. So yes, this is an evidence that we can actually quantify, use this technique as a metrology technique for nanophotonics. And I would like to highlight the fact then that today in nanophotonics, it's turns out to be very important to develop some metrology tools in nanophotonics, especially because more and more new materials are invented, are proposed in nanophotonics. Plasmonics, dielectric material, hybrid nanoparticles, more and more complex nanoparticles. And when the particle turns to be very complex, it's very hard to predict the optical properties. It's very hard to run numerical simulations, for instance, because you don't necessarily know the permittivity of the material. So at some point, the only way to describe, to characterize a material is to measure. And we believe this is a perfect tool to characterize nanoparticles, because with one single measurement, you retrieve all the optical properties of the nanoparticles. And something that we found very interesting is that this technique, the measurements you perform, they are very robust. They are very robust because they do not depend on the focus. But this is unexpected, this is counterintuitive, because when you vary the focus, the two images, intensity and phase, they are varying a lot. For instance, on the left, you vary the focus plus and minus half a micrometer. And as expected, the intensity and phase images are highly dependent. You even have a contrast inversion for the phase image. But still, using this expression here, it doesn't vary the alpha. Although the images are varying, when you couple them this way, you end up with a quantity that is independent of the focus. And what is interesting as well is that we have the same effect for the numerical aperture. If you shrink it, you get a bigger airy disk, airy pattern, but counterintuitively, it doesn't change anything when you sum all the pixels as the expression you have here. So this makes the estimation of alpha very robust. You can misalign your setup, unfocus it, don't really know what the numerical aperture is of your objective, it doesn't matter, we'll always measure the same polarizability. So I'm Going now to the second part of my talk regarding imaging of 2D materials, unless we have some other questions from the audience regarding this first part on
So I have a couple of questions probably. So first of all, what is the limitation of the size of the nanoparticle? So you mentioned something like around 100 nanometers, yeah?
Yeah, so 100 nanometers, this is the signal-to-noise ratio you have observed here, which is very good. I mean, you clearly see them. We also detected 80 nanometer nanoparticles, but then the signal goes down very fast because it's proportional to the volume of the particle. So already 60 is very hard to see. But these are the very first steps we are doing in this direction. So we are currently trying to improve the sensitivity. We have different ideas to improve it. So far, QLSI has never been thought, has never been optimized to image nanoparticles. It has been optimized to image living cells. So for sure, there are some optimization to do to detect smaller and smaller nanoparticles. So yes, to answer your question, if you have gold nanoparticles down to maybe 70 nanometers, you can easily see them. Below that, it becomes to be hard.
And the second question is regarding, you mentioned some other fancy materials and promising materials for nanophotonics. So I wonder, does this work for dielectric nanoresonators, some silicon or whatever?
Yeah, it works for anything.
Okay.
Well, I have presented two type of materials, polystyrene,
okay, yeah,
plasmonics, so dielectric and metal, but anything that is acting like a particle that is affecting the wavefront, we can see it and characterize it.
Okay.
The theory that is behind doesn't make any assumption on the composition of the particle.
Yeah, thank you very much.
So 2D material, actually what we have done is to look at all the drawers we had in our lab to pass everything on the microscope, and it turns out that we had some 2D materials. And in particular, what you can see on the right are molybdenum disulfide flakes. So molybdenum disulfide consists of three atomic layer of atoms. And they can be large, quite large, a few micron big. And what we have shown is that you can also do some metrology on this type of material. But this time what you measure is not a polarizability, it's what is called a complex conductivity. It relates the current you have, the two-dimensional current you have in your material, with the total electric field. And this way, the expression is a bit different. You still have the square root of the intensity and the expansion of the phase, but you have to mix them differently to achieve this measurement. And then the difference is that you don't get a number, you get an image. Sigma is an image, it's a map of the complex conductivity of the material. So we have done that to retrieve the complex conductivity that you can transform as well in a complex refractive index if you wish. And this is what is plotted on the left of the slide. This is our measurements, so real part and imaginary part of the refractive index, compared with what was measured in the literature. So we are not bad, we are very close, but at the same time, data are very scattered. So we are within the range of the data reported in the community. And what we measured also is the conductivity as a function of the wavelength, the photon energy. And again, we are very close to what was measured by Morozov. So this comforts us in the fact that we are measuring something real. And of course, what we had also in our drawers was graphene, the most famous 2D material. So it's even thinner than MOS2, but still we can detect it. It's only one carbon atom thick, and still it is distorting enough the wavefront so that we can measure it. So wavefront distortion is half a nanometer, but the technique is sensitive enough to have a good signal-to-noise ratio. And actually, at that time, we didn't even have the best wavefront sensor or the best QLSI camera we have today. So if we were trying today to image again graph unit to even be better than this image here. So you have phase image, intensity image, the profiles, and image D is a Raman measurement to make sure that we have single and double layer on this image here. So again, we measure the real and imaginary part of graphene, and again, we are consistent with everything that was reported in the literature. So you see that data are scattered. There is no even two groups measuring the same thing. I don't think it's related to techniques that are good, not good, that have a bias. I think they're all good, all fine. It's more related to the samples. Graphene samples, they can be done different, many different ways, and in some cases, they can be different. In particular, you can have some remaining polymer on top that you don't see it using Raman spectroscopy, for instance, but you can see it clearly using quantitative phase microscopy. So this is also an advantage of benefit of using QLSI, is that you can test the quality of graphene you are looking at.
Yes, sir. I have yeah. Probably a very naive question, but since I was working only with bulk materials or like 3D nanoparticles, I wonder what does refractive index means for monolayers?
Yeah. So this is something we discussed, a very interesting point we discussed in the paper. At the beginning, we didn't want to give this kind of image with the refractive index, because refractive index doesn't mean anything for graphene. It's one atomic, so one atom thick, so it doesn't mean anything. What means something is the connectivity. You can talk about a two-dimensional connectivity without any problem, even if you have something perfectly flat. But refractive index assumes a thickness. So if you provide your graphene layer with a thickness, which is is the name for that, an arbitrary thickness, then you can define, by a simple division, you can define a refractive index. But this is only arbitrary. And what people are taking for the thickness is the distance between two graphene layers in graphite. But it's only a choice. You can use something else if you want. So the definition of N here, the measurement, is only arbitrary. And this arbitrariness, there is no need to define something arbitrary while you can use the optical connectivity. So yes, we discussed it, so it doesn't make sense. This N is only arbitrary, to answer your question.
Okay. And the second question is regarding, you mentioned that QLSI can give you some information on the quality of the monolayer, yes? Did I get it correctly?
Yes, so I don't have the slides here, but...
No, I just wanted to ask, so since Raman scattering is also giving some information on the crystallinity, on the phonons of the lattice, so I wonder, how this QLSI works in comparison with Raman, or is it any better, or what are the limitations?
So first this image, I mean, the phase image is only 1 second. You have these two images in one second. You can even have it live. You can actually can even be faster than this. So this camera, I didn't say it, but it's provided by the Phasics company. It's a patented technology, so they are the only one in the world to provide this technology. And they very recently developed an algorithm based on the GPU that is giving you live imaging, very fast processing of the phase images from the interferogram. So you can have like 15 hertz imaging. So it's very fast. You can have these two images very fast. You can even walk around your sample trying to find single sheets graphene. Raman spectroscopy, it's like 1 minute to get this image. It's very slow. So yes, you have the information, but it's very slow. You cannot use Raman to look for a fast investigation of where the one layer is. So this is a benefit. Then, for some fabrication techniques, you can have a remaining polymer layer on top of graphene. This is what we have seen. We first got graphene from group in Lille, the group of Dominique Vigneault, and the optical thickness was 2 nanometer, much bigger than theory. So we have been wondering why for a while, but until we figure out that actually he had a remaining polymer layer on top of graphene. And he never see that because there is no way to realize that you have this layer on top. And we were able to see it and quantify it, the thickness and the material using QLSI. And this is something you do not see with a Raman spectroscopy.
Yes, Raman is such a pain. It requires a lot of time. Yeah, I know that. So there is one more question in the chat by also Dr. Ivansinov. So for TMDCs, were you able to extract any excitant parameters from your measurements? Oscillator strength, lifetime, it should be possible to retrieve once you have spectral dependence on the conductivity.
I guess, I'm not a specialist in this, but I guess since it is you achieve, you can measure the complex conductivity. You can measure what you just mentioned. I'm not sure, but what you can measure, and this is the only thing you can measure, is the optical conductivity. And everything that derives from the optical conductivity, you can extract it. So regarding the lifetime of anything in the material, if it is dependent on this complex number, and I guess it is, maybe there is a way, to retrieve what you mentioned.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay, and the last part of my talk concerned what you can do, how you can use QLSI technique to measure temperature on the micro scale. So this is something I have done quite a lot this last 10 years. Most of my research time actually consisted in heating nanoparticles using light. You send light on nanoparticles, they absorb light, they heat the environment, and you can do some interesting physics with that. So the challenge in this field of research is not really to heat. This is very simple. If you can afford buying nanoparticles and a laser, you send the laser and the nanoparticle and you will heat. So nothing challenging in that. The challenge rather consists in measuring the temperature. Measuring the temperature at the micro scale, this is what is complicated, what is challenging. Don't use any thermocouple. It will be much too invasive for this task. So what we have realized is that you can use QLSI. So the basic principle is explained here. Sorry. So you send a laser on a gold nanoparticle, and when it's heated, it heats also the surrounding, and especially the liquid around. And this creates a variation of the refractive index in the liquid. So then you have a distortion of the plane wave, incoming plane wave, due to this gradient of refractive index in the liquid. So first, what is not clear in my slide is that you have two light sources in this experiment. One from the bottom to heat, which is a laser, and one from the top that will probe the temperature gradient that will be imaged using the QLSI camera. Then you have the particle. And we have just seen that the particle is itself distorting the wavefront. So you're going to have two contributions, one wavefront distortion due to the particle and one due to the temperature gradient. But what we are doing is to take a first image without heating, second image with heating, and we subtract the two phase images. This way we get rid of the contribution of the particle and end up only with an image due to the temperature profile. So here you have a phase image or an optical thickness image, because it's in nanometers, of the wavefront distortion created by the temperature gradient when we heat a single gold nanoparticle. Well, I mentioned the temperature microscopy technique. This is not a temperature profile, okay? This is a wavefront distortion due to a three-dimensional temperature profile. That's a bit complicated, but what we have shown is that doing some theory, we can retrieve the three-dimensional temperature profile from this phase profile. So this is what is shown here. So here, this is the same image of a single gold nanoparticle. We shine a laser on that, and this is the associated wavefront distortion. And from this wavefront distortion, using an algorithm, we retrieve the temperature profile. And also, what is very interesting, the power per unit area. And it's a very unique quantity that is not that cannot be measured using any other macroscopy techniques. All temperature macroscopy techniques, they measure temperature, but not this power density. And if you sum all the pixels, you can even measure the power delivered by the particle in the surroundings. This technique, this approach is not only working for a single nanoparticle, but for like a carpet for many nanoparticles. If you eliminate many of them, naturally you have a wider wavefront distortion, a wider heat source density, and a wider temperature distribution. So mapping, measuring temperature in plasmonics, this is quite recent. I mean, thermoplasmonics dates from the beginning of the 2000s, but we had to wait almost 10 years before people start measuring temperature in plasmonics. So first techniques date from 2009-10, and they were based on fluorescence measurements. Basically, people that disperse fluorescent molecules all around the particles, and just because fluorescence depends on temperature, if you map fluorescence, you map the temperature. But fluorescent molecules that can be affected by temperature increase suffer from photobleaching, thermobleaching, so they are artifacts. The benefit of our approach here is that it's label-free. You don't need to modify your sample. You don't do anything to your sample. You just plug this camera on your microscope and you measure the temperature. So this is like an overview of all the microscopy, temperature microscopy technique. Oh, it's in French. I'm sorry, the title is in French. All the microscopy techniques that have been developed in plasmonics to measure the temperature in plasmonics. So the line we are interested in here is called the line wavefront sensing. So each dot is one paper. At some point, I should update this graph because it dates from 2016. But more and more people have been developed and used in thermoplasmonics. So this is a typical experiment we have done in the past to heat nanoparticles. We had a carpet of gold nanoparticles. We shine light and create a temperature gradient. So this is a side view of the experiment, laser from the bottom, gold nanoparticle heat generation in the liquid. And this is one of the first image we get from the algorithm we have developed. So we were very surprised when we have seen this image. I don't know if you feel surprised by this image, but we were. What is very surprising is this, in this image is the temperature increase we reached. We reached almost 200 degrees, but we are in water. So at some point we should expect a bubble, but we didn't. We did observe a bubble above 200 degrees, but not below, and not in particular at 100 degrees. So at the beginning, we thought we had a problem with the algorithm, maybe a factor of two in any equation, I don't know. But actually, no, this temperature increase was real. We did achieve a superheated state of water in this kind of experiment. So why do we observe this? The reason why you can boil water in your kitchen at 100 degrees, that's because you have nucleation points in the pan you are using to cook, for instance, which means scratches, roughness, pieces of dust. This is why you have boiling at 100 degrees. If you don't have this, if the vessel is perfectly flat, smooth at the micro scale, you don't boil water. You achieve a superheated state of the liquid. So this is well known actually by the chemist community. This is why they put this kind of porous stone within the vessels they use when they want to boil water to avoid explosive boiling. This is because they use glassware and there is nothing flatter than glass. This is why they can achieve superheating in their glassware in their vessels. And this is why we achieve here superheating, because we are using glass cover slips. So we were happy to understand that. We share this knowledge with the community. And then we thought, is there any interest to heat water at 200 degrees without boiling? And the answer is yes. Actually, again, the chemists, they use 200 degree water as a solvent quite a lot. This is called the solvothermal chemistry or hydrothermal chemistry. And you can do some fancy chemistry with such a solvent. But for this kind of application, to avoid boiling, you need to use pressure chambers, which are called autoclaves, which is a bit not convenient, because you have to close your reaction medium, screw, then you do not see anything anymore on what you are doing. So what we thought, we could achieve hydrothermal chemistry, but in ambient pressure, under a microscope, check what's happening using a microscope, add some reactants during the reaction. So this could be a new paradigm for chemistry. So this is what we did, and instead of using autoclaves, we used micro dishes. The pink color you see at the bottom is the layer of gold nanoparticles. We put some liquid on top, reactants, shine a laser, heat. And in the literature, we have found this interesting chemical reaction consisting in the production of indium hydroxide crystals. We picked this reaction because the products are crystals, so they are very easy to spot, to see. And it worked. We achieved the same kind of geometry, same kind of crystallography. These are the crystals we achieved by heating the gold nanoparticle carpet. So first, it was the evidence that we can achieve superheating state of water. And it evidenced the possibility to achieve hydrothermal chemistry using the plasmonics approach. And the advantage, the benefit we evidenced also was that you can do some fundamental research in that. What you can do using a laser compared with using an autoclave is to create a microscale temperature gradient. And using the phase camera, using QLSI, you can even measure the temperature gradient. And what we have seen is that we have observed some temperature threshold from one crystallography to another. So we did see these cubes, but if we heat even more, we can see these pine tree shapes. And using one single experiment, we could extract what was the temperature threshold. If you are a chemist and you use an autoclave and you want to answer this question, you have to conduct many, many experiments in many autoclaves at many different temperatures to answer the question. With this approach, one experiment, a few minutes of heating, and you have the answer. So this was the benefit we evidenced using this approach. So of course, this approach using QLSI cannot be used to achieve an industrial amount of crystals, of products. This is not the aim. What we think is that QLSI can be used for fundamental research in hydrothermal chemistry. So far I have talked about what you can do in physics and chemistry when you heat on the micro scale, and my last part will be dedicated to what you can do in biology. What we wanted to do is to heat single cells. So heating cells, this is a full field of research, because cells, living cells, they are very sensitive to temperature, of course. Some of them, they are blossoming at 37, but if you heat them at 40 degrees, that's already a problem for them. And in particular, they try to fight this temperature increase by producing proteins. When you heat a cell, this unfolds the proteins, which is very bad news for the cell. And so the cell, in this case, is producing heat shock proteins that will repair these unfolded proteins and protect them. So this is a very smart approach by nature. And to follow this, usually you do that using fluorescence. So what we can do using our approach is to still image the temperature using QLSI. also image the phase morphology using also QLSI. So you have a double use of the technique, phase microscopy technique, and in parallel, perform fluorescence measurements. And just because our technique is not based on fluorescent molecules, we are completely free to use any fluorophore you want, we want to image the fluorescence. So this is really a benefit for biologists. If they want to measure temperature in their living cells, they won't be annoyed by this temperature microscopy technique. So biologists, when they want to study the response of cells to a temperature shock, they label the cells so that when you heat them, they produce, you can see the appearance of granules within cells. So here we are heating with a laser, laser off and laser on. And when it is on, you can see the appearance of the granules within the nucleus, and it is off, they disappear. So here we reproduce what biologists are observing, but when heating the whole holder of the microscope, or even the whole microscope itself, to 37, 38, 40, and so on. So now we are doing it, but using a single laser spot at the micro scale, and it's working as well. So what is the benefit of doing this? Why did we choose to do this? Well, that's because when you heat on the micro scale, you heat very fast. In 1 microsecond, you increase, you have the temperature steady state. So you can go from 37 to 41 in a few milliseconds, which means that you have the time zero to study any temperature-induced response of the cell. So you do you need such a dynamics? Actually, yes. Yes. So this is the time evolution of the fluorescence of the granules. So in the nucleus, we have 2 granules. Here, 1 and 2, this corresponds to the 2 granules. And as you can see, after a few seconds, you already have the response of the cell. The cell is already expressing the proteins. It will be used to protect the damaged proteins. When you heat, like any biologist, at the macro scale, your sample holder or your microscope, the inertia is huge. You have to wait a few minutes, 10 minutes sometimes, 15 minutes, to achieve the steady state. So you cannot achieve such a dynamics. So this one of the benefits we evidence upon heating at the micro scale, you have the time zero to investigate any temperature-induced dynamics in living cells. And also, if for any reason you heat too much and you kill everyone, also cells you are looking at, if you are using a laser, you only damage a few cells, the cells in the field of view, and then you just have to move other spot of your micro dish, try another temperature, other conditions, so you can work the whole day with a single micro dish and investigate many parameters at once. So this is also one benefit compared to heating the whole micro dish. So this work has been done mostly by my PhD students in 2018. Okay, so regarding this last part of on temperature microscopy, what the message that I wanted to provide was that as soon as you heat something, you can investigate any field of science. Just because in any field of science, you have temperature-induced effects. And in 10 minutes, I've talked about application in physics, chemistry, and biology. So the main take-home messages of this talk is that as soon as you image the phase of light, yes, you can find applications in biology, but actually in many fields of science, and in particular in nanophotonics. So just to go back to the very first slide of my talk, so just in case not everyone was here at the beginning, so this very busy slide was to show you that quantitative phase microscopy was mainly used in biology. So I bet that in maybe 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, this slide will be half nanophotonics, half biology. I don't know, but I won't be surprised because this, in particular QLSI, appear to us like the ideal tool to perform metrology in nanophotonics. And nanophotonics is a huge field of research. So I'm done with my presentation. I just wanted to acknowledge all my colleagues and people I've been working with. In particular, Samir Akkadir and Adrien Robert. So they are the two people who contributed the most to both the nanophotonics application and temperature mapping applications. And this is where the money is coming from. And thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much, Guillaume. So, dear colleagues, it's high time to ask the questions. So while people are either typing, okay, yeah, there's a raised hand by Dr. Ivan Sinov. Yes, Ivan, please.
Yes, Guillaume, thank you very much for the very interesting talk. I was particularly interested in this characterization of 2D materials because, yeah, we deal a lot with them. And my question was, firstly, so as far as I understood, the characteristic you are measuring this surface conductivity is actually an average over the whole structure, or you can do some kind of mapping and take into account some of the, you know, inhomogeneity.
Okay, so when we want to plot a graph, we have to take an average. So these are the graphs I have shown, but no, in general, we have an image. Let me go back to this slide. The difference between the nanoparticle case and the 2D material case is that with the nanoparticle case, you have a number. This alpha is a number because you integrate the sum of the pixels. But this expression sigma is an image. Sigma is an image. So what you can achieve is an image. So this is very interesting also for 2D materials because you can evidence any non-uniformity of the complex conductivity.
Okay, yeah, thank you. And I already asked about this resonant behavior, this surface conductivity. As far as I saw, you had one slide with kind of resonant behavior.
Yeah.
So does this correspond to the exciton or not? I mean, this increase of the...
I don't remember. I'm not sure about that. I don't know.
Probably this is slightly off in terms of frequency. I mean, this is very interesting because the characteristics of the exciton are usually defined using, well, also some posterior experiments like in this strong coupling regime. And if you are able to characterize the main parameters of the exciton just from this measurement, this might be very useful, yeah, you know, for characterization of 2D materials, like pristine layers, I mean, as soon as they are produced. And then it can be used for further fabrication of hybrid structures. So yeah, very interesting. Thank you.
So this is a good point, and I really think that what I have presented today is really a starting point for a full field of research. There are many, many things that we can think of. You just mentioned a strong coupled system. So yes, you can measure any splitting of resonance or of any strong coupled system at the micro scale, even map how the strong coupling appears in two dimensions. So yes, there are many things we can think of from what I have presented today.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, Guillaume, so I have another question. First of all, very exciting results, especially on single cell heating and thermometry. So I wonder, according to one of your papers, if you use pulsed laser heating, you achieve a sharper spatial distribution of the temperature. So I think for some optical heating applications in biology, it's very important to keep the thermal distribution very tight, since not to overheat relatively, or I would say healthy tissue. So I wonder, is this also always a trade-off between the spatial distribution and the ability to measure the temperature, since for some pulsed heating applications it's very difficult to measure the temperature?
Yeah, so under pulsed illumination, yes, the extent, the if you send a pulse, femtosecond pulse, femtosecond laser pulse on a nanoparticle, it's so fast that temperature won't have time to diffuse in the environment. So you will only heat a very small liquid layer around the particle. But this is when talking about the envelope of the temperature increase. So the maximum temperature over time you have follows a very tight distribution. However, the average temperature, not the average temperature over time, but the, sorry, not the maximum temperature over time, but the average temperature over time follows the temperature distribution. Sorry, the steady state temperature distribution. So my message is that if you use our technique in pulsed illumination, you will observe a regular 1/r temperature distribution, not a confined temperature distribution, because we are measuring the time averaged temperature profile.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. So colleagues, are there any other questions? So as far as I see from the chat and from the audience, there are no further questions. So with that, I would like to thank Guillaume once again for accepting our invitation and giving a very brilliant talk on our seminar. And before we finish the seminar, I would like to make a small announcement. So the next optical seminar will be next Friday, and the talk will be given by Dr. Ilya Vatnik from Novosibirsk State University. The seminar will be also at 5 p.m. So please, the topic will be controlling and utilizing optical whispering gallery modes on surface of optical fibers. So with that, thanks again to everyone for joining our seminar. Stay safe and good luck. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Bye.